please welcome to the stage Lenny James, Alicia Debnam Carey, Danai Garcia, Maggie Grace, Jenna Elfman, Austin Emilio, Alexa Nisenson, Ruben Blades, and Karen David. Your 2019 Fear the Walking Dead lineup. So, Lenny, let's start with you.
Thank you, Mouse.
Welcome. Nice to see you.
Good to see you.
Very nice to see you. Morgan has really finally seemed like he's evened out a bit. He seems okay. And this mission where the group is offering to basically go out and help others, you know, for this part of season 5 of Fear the Walking Dead, what can you say about that?
It's a mission about taking the biggest risk in the apocalypse, which is the risk on the future. And it's the thing to do. Now that we're surviving, what do we do next? And it's the what we're doing next that Morgan is trying to encourage everybody to think about and to figure out.
Right. Alicia, this is from Irina283 on Twitter. Season 4 was all about revenge and coming to terms with what happened to her family. What has this season been about for her?
I think for her it's been this journey of being then just a protector and being separated from people because she can't afford to lose anyone anymore, and she's just so just completely stifled by the idea of not being able to protect enough, so that's all she's doing. But she's now trying for the first time to, with Morgan's guidance, I think, to actually open up, because that's the only way she's going to connect back to who she is and herself. So I think she's kind of lost who she is.
But don't you think she's kind of finding her humanity a little bit again? I mean, she really did go off for a while.
Yeah, oh yeah. And now she's finally trying to reconnect, and that's her going after the kids, and that's her trying to let those walls down and feel again and be open to loving and emotion and what it means to potentially be happy. But it's almost kind of ironic the moment she does that, we see her suddenly put in jeopardy almost instantaneously.
Right. So, Danai, Luciana has had a lot of injuries.
Oh my God.
And she keeps coming back.
You know what's funny? We just went to the dead zone, and the first thing Ian and I just said, Danai, watch out the poles. And I literally said, oh my God, I'm so traumatized. Like, I was actually looking for a pole that would not spin me to the, looking at Lenny like, hey, can you take it out? And,
but where does Luciana find the will to keep, you know, getting knocked down, get up, keep fighting and pushing through?
You know, I think it just happened when you less expect it. And what's weird is that when you're in that situation, you just start finding the strength to go over the obstacle. And what I realized this season is that, you know, usually these characters, they're out killing zombies and just dealing with the apocalypse. But Luciana was like so still. And when you're still, not because you want to, because you have to, you start thinking mentally of, you become stronger mentally. Like, okay, I have no choice. I need to find the strength to deal with this because it's not natural.
Right.
And thank goodness I had Dylan to hang out with. That was amazing.
Maggie Grace, the episode 5 this season, when Al meets Isabel, is an incredible story, especially because for Al, she's been so almost emotionally removed from everything. We haven't really gotten a peek, you know, into her soul that much. And then we see this beautiful episode where she meets someone and decides to open up with Isabel, who almost kills her. So is there anything people would be surprised to learn about shooting that episode, or anything you want to say about that episode?
I loved that episode. I just felt like it was such a gift. Thank you, guys. I felt like the characters had great chemistry, and it was really an honor and a pleasure to shoot. And surprising, I feel like there was sort of a Maggie Grace dragging machine with a camera above it, and then you had like my arms and legs bound to metal bars and would like drag me along the hill so they could get that shot. Because for everything you see on screen for a couple seconds, it's like, you know, we've done it like 50 times.
Right.
There was a lot of a lot of surprising stunts that episode, and a real cliff. I mean, we were hooked in and super safe, but I think we all get used to thinking that the things we see are all CG, and there's so many awesome practical effects, and we have such a great stunt team, Jack Tamplin and James Armstrong, that we love.
I think you sent us like a photo of all the bruises, like on your arms and legs when you wrapped.
Yeah, Mikey, yeah, I was like, look at my knee. It was like a badge of honor. We're like a soccer team at the end. We're like, you know, comparing bruises.
I mean, does she, now that she's kind of open up to someone on the, do you feel like this is a slightly different, more open direction for her going forward, or do you think she might sort of wall back up again?
I mean, I hope so. I think for someone like Al, you know, not only being able to connect and sort of recognize who Isabel is so deeply, I think also knowing that there's this organization out there that's so advanced and has all this technology, it would be hard for Al to be like, you're right, I should just put that to bed, you know, not pursue that. It's hard to walk away and live with that every day, I think. It's a big mystery.
Jenna, June has also started as someone who didn't trust anyone, who was always trying to run away, and then she finally found a home and seems to have settled, and her relationship with John Dory is incredible. The two of them together are amazing. And how will we see her continue to evolve the rest of the season?
I think it's good and bad when you find someone like John Dory, because especially when you are so broken and he's so healing, you know, the John Dory effect is so healing, and then she holds on to that very tight because it holds the whole world still for her. It holds everything calm. And I think as she, you know, as we come into this mid-season finale, you know, she can't find him. She can't raise him on the walkie, and she's having to face kind of her worst nightmare, this idea of how, she's facing what she had before when she was separated from him, which is the advice she gives Al, but that was before she actually had the relationship. And now she's in so deep on this relationship and it's so healing for her, she's facing the idea of like, what could I? What if I don't find him? What will that do to her? You know, and this idea of that threat isn't great for her, but also, you know, I had someone tell me once, you don't need confidence in order to do something. You do actions, and by doing them, you gain the confidence. And that's how you build confidence. And I think that's separate from the love with John. She's doing again and participating, and that's building her confidence. And I think she's, you know, really been pulling herself out of the muck. So I think while she's getting stronger and stronger, she's also becoming more vulnerable and more vulnerable with not knowing what's going to happen with John.
Yeah, and also just this whole plan that the group has had this part of the season is, I mean...
Did I talk too long?
No, you're great. No, you're great.
All smiling.
Austin and I had a deal, like, who got to carry Garrett's picture out here.
Did you guys bring it?
Yeah, we brought it.
Garrett couldn't be here. Oh, did you already put it up there? Can someone zoom in on that? Because that's a really great... You want to hold it up over here?
We were making eye contact. It's like, I won rock, paper, scissors. Sorry.
I don't know if this is from a personal collection.
a fan of Facebook brought it today.
That's Garrett Dillahunt on the hunt, it turns out.
That is from Terminator Tarzan Chronicles.
Oh, this is from the Sarah Connor Chronicles.
Yes.
The fan that brought it to me just assured me that it was not, in fact, photoshopped. Thank you, Jason, for your very important contribution to today's panel.
I feel like an homage to this needs to turn up somewhere.
In a dream sequence.
In a dream sequence. That then becomes a real sequence.
This is what happens when you can't make the panel because you're shooting.
That's what happens. Karen, welcome to the show. Welcome to Comic-Con. Lovely to have you here.
This is my first time here.
It's your first time at Comic-Con. Welcome. Well, welcome.
I'm so in awe. Like, I'm fangirling over my cast and all you lovelies. So, hi.
How I'd love that they almost kind of did the accent too. Hi, like it was very sweet. So how do you prepare for the role of a nuclear scientist in an apocalypse?
No pressure at all.
None.
It was a really quick turnover when I found out that I was joining the show, So I immediately went straight to the books, and I was Googling about different examples of nuclear explosions, and of course Chernobyl came up, and at the time I had no idea that there was going to be a show that was being made, which by the way is absolutely brilliant. And watching that, and also doing the research and just seeing so many images of when life used to exist and families, and it was just soul destroying. And I needed to feel exactly the weight of all that and really immerse myself in those feelings, especially for Grace, coming into Grace's shoes. She carries so much guilt on her shoulders because of the choices and decisions that she made. She thought she was helping everyone. She thought she was doing something for the greater good. And when that all fell apart and she started to see the people that she cared about, that she worked with at the plant, that all kind of crumbled in front of her and destroyed her. And the only thing for her to keep up with survival is trying to make things right as best as she could. And that's why she doesn't want any of these guys affected at all whatsoever, especially because she's to blame for it all.
I just want to say, beautiful first answer at your first Comic-Con.
Oh, thank you.
And also, speaking of first Comic-Cons, Alexa Nicenson, this is your first Comic-Con. No, you were at WonderCon. Oh. This is your first San Diego Comic-Con, right?
My first Comic-Con, yes.
All right, great. Well, welcome to San Diego Comic-Con. We have a question. We have a question from @BigDog16 on Twitter, who says, "Alexa, how exciting was it flying in a hot air balloon resembling a beer bottle?"
It was amazing. It really was just one of probably the coolest things I've ever done, and getting to do it with Coleman made it like 10 times better. You know, I feel like if you're gonna get like trapped inside of a hot air balloon with someone, like Coleman is the best one to do it with. But yeah, I also just look up to him so much, and he's an amazing mentor. But I also really love that we got to work on our character's bond, and doing something like that, flying on the hot air balloon, I think brought our characters closer, doing something extraordinary like that. But one of my other favorite things about that scene is how last season, you know, we saw Charlie kind of go against the group. But this season, we really saw her with this hot air balloon come up with this idea to potentially save the group. And I just loved getting to see her feel so proud of herself that she's come up with this idea to save her group that took her in. And getting to see her evolve has just been really, really amazing.
She has really evolved.
Yeah.
Kind of in a similar way to June. It was just like she didn't trust a lot of outside people. Oh. And now, do we trust her now? We trust her. I feel like we trust her.
Well.
It's up to you guys. Oh.
Mentioning Coleman Domingo, Coleman couldn't be here, so he wrote a message that he wanted me to read. This is from Coleman. "I'm currently in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, shooting a film. Hopefully there is someone killing it when it comes to a color palette and some style. I'm in all gray. I'm sure Alicia is bringing it, Jen is bringing it, Maggie's bringing it, Ruben Blades is probably wearing all black. Look at him, I'm quite sure he is, but maybe he went crazy today and just wore hot pink or something. No. I'm sure Alexa's killing it, Austin's looking cool and sick, but people got style anyway. Hope you guys are having fun. Take care, and hopefully I'll see you again soon. Be well." That was from Coleman.
Such a Coleman.
He's the best. Coleman Domingo is the sweetest. He's the absolute best. And speaking of Ruben down there, dressed in all black, welcome back to the show, by the way. It's great to have you back.
Thank you.
The fans were so excited about your return. Daniel Salazar is such a wonderful character. And you know, people missed him, and so you're back. How do you describe his mindset at this point in the show?
Well, first of all, thank you, all of you, because you are the ones responsible for Salazar. Thank you very much for bringing him. Well, right now, I mean, it's an interesting situation, because after the dam scenario, which I'm sure will be explained at some point, he had to find a reason to live. I mean, his wife, Griselda's gone, his daughter is gone. And I think that independent from what Morgan arrived at, Salazar figured, you know, I'm alive for a reason, there must be a purpose for me. because everyone around me has died except me. So I think that he made up his mind about being of use to others and having the knowledge that he has to put it at the service of others. It's interesting because it happened at the same time that Morgan was also thinking about helping other people and with that atoning for past sins. In Salazar's case, I think he's trying to provide a reason for him to live. And I think helping others is it. But that doesn't mean, you know, he will help you, but if you cross him, he'll kill you. I think. I mean, I don't think that that's ever going to be gone.
Don't mess with me.
This is for Ruben. This is from Instagram. 17 Castiel wants to know, and this is actually a question a lot of people had. And you and I actually talked about this last night at the AMC dinner, and you were very emphatic about it. How was the cat trained to play Skidmark? How was Skidmark the cat?
The cat right now, by the way, he's in Europe in a cat convention. Actually, you know, I wanted Salazar to have a companion. And at the beginning I thought a dog, and he said no. And I would imagine that is because Daryl had a dog. But at that point, I didn't know that. So anyways, I said, can we have a cat? And they said, no, a cat? I said, yeah, they're very difficult. I said, you know, cat. So about 3 months later, I got a call. They said, you got the cat. I said, what cat? The cat that you want? Oh, yeah, okay. So the cat is there. I think the cat is wonderful. I think it's well trained. And you know, you have, of course, a stunt cat. And then you have the actor cat just watches, you know.
Smoking.
Smoking a cigarette.
Pretty good, yeah.
Looking at his...
I could do that. I just don't feel like it. I could do that.
Getting him something else. But it's a lot of fun. I mean, it's a great cat. And you'd be amazed how... I was amazed how good he is. I mean, he follows orders. You ever try to talk to a cat? But so it's a great cat. I mean, I love him. And I'm sure that he's a star right now. And you have made him a star. It's a lot of fun.
I will be excited at the proliferation of cats named Skidmark going forward. Austin, I talked about this a little bit before when the executive producers were out here, but I was really excited to see Dwight come on the show because obviously he was pretty limited in what he was able to do. Pretty limited in what he was able to do on Walking Dead Prime, that he was kind of locked into something. And now we're actually getting to see him open up, and I feel like we're getting to explore his character more and getting to understand him a little bit better. Can you talk a little bit about Dwight running into John and June and what your experience has been like on the show so far?
Yeah, I mean, when we first come across Dwight, he's sort of been on this year-long mission, and I sort of describe it as like an addict trying to get his fix a little bit to find his wife. So when we see him, he's in a very dark place. And when he comes across June and John, it takes a little bit to, he hasn't been around people in a while. So there he sort of has to have some faith in these people that he meets, and I think he really ends up relating to John very quickly. And by the way, getting to work with Jenna and Garrett is, I sort of geek out on it a little bit because they're kind of these gigantic actors to me, and it's incredible to work with them. And then also the introduction that I got to have was, I felt very appropriate. You know, it's a very Western, like, wow. You know, and you just see my hand come in, and we're in a small Western town in Texas, and it was kind of a bucket list intro, so I was very excited about it.
And then for Andrew and Ian, to, you know, obviously Morgan's crossed over from the show, and now Dwight has crossed over from the show, so how does it change how you see the two shows as they as the universes really start kind of melding together as showrunners? What is your sort of, what are you looking ahead to see?
Yeah, I mean, I think for us, it's really like looking at kind of the stories we want to tell and the themes we want to explore and look to see what characters would be kind of the best vehicles for that. And that's what kind of drove the decision to bring Dwight over.
Yeah, that's what was really exciting. You know, as Austin says, given the mission that Dwight was on when he left The Walking Dead and the mission or the story that we told with John and June last season, it was this perfect intersection of stories where they were in the perfect position to help each other. So that's the cool thing about being able to connect the worlds.
Great. This is from the internet. We're taking questions from the internet. Alicia Devon Carey from Instagram, Paulus PSJ. Alicia, do you think Alicia with an I is ready to be in a relationship?
I get that question so much.
It said most asked. On the
really?
Card.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's just not quite as much a skid mark, but it's, you know,
right.
It's up there, right?
Does skid mark need a relationship?
Yeah, it's more pressing, definitely.
This is skid mark's relationship right here. This is skid mark's.
That's
six. Yeah.
I don't think she's quite there yet, but I think it's. She, for her to have a relationship, it really needs to be someone who can make her feel safe. I think she's never felt particularly safe since everything fell apart. And even before then, you know, her brother being a drug addict, like her mother having a lot of attention on him growing up without a father, you know, she's always felt like she had to be the protector in a sense. And I think that's probably why she's found herself in this role currently. You know, in this world. So for someone to come along, they'd have to be pretty, to make her feel safe and to make her feel like, you know, she's protected for once, not the other way around. But you know, there is definitely, I'd like to see that. I think it would be nice to see her have some happiness in her future that's, you know, in a world that's not all just like guts and blood and killing. You know, it would be nice for her to have some lightness, so yeah.
Well, that's sort of the push and pull of the show, is anytime a character gets happy, you just go, oh,
it's
crap.
Like, oh,
yeah.
No, I'm gonna die now.
Well, this just sort of, this sort of leads into another question from Facebook, Gwyneth A. Alicia, after everything Alicia has been through, who does she put the most trust in now?
Oh my God, I don't know. I mean, she's been with Strand, maybe, and Luciana the longest. So I guess it's like, that's a family kind of aspect, but I think she reopened up when Morgan kind of came along too. I think there was like a, I have to trust you because you're trying so hard to not just let me disappear. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I think she, yeah, Morgan just wouldn't stop trying, so I think she's probably let that in and being like, all right, fine. I trust you, I get it. I don't know. So yeah, interesting question there.
This is from Susan P. on Facebook for Jenna Elfman. Jenna, do you think June would consider having another child or just survive as is with John?
I think she doesn't need to go through the idea of another child right now. That's one is enough. That was an experience. I think she's good to jump.
Okay. For Lenny, what was it like shooting your first scene with Austin again?
It was surreal because it wasn't until we were shooting the film that shooting the scene that we realized we had actually never done a scene together before, never spoken words together. We had to leave Virginia, Atlanta, and walk halfway across the country to do a scene together. It's a lot of effort, but it was well worth it. I was glad that Austin was around. In fact, Austin was my first phone call when moving to Fear was a possibility, because he's Austin from Austin, and that's where we shoot it. So I phoned him up and I said, tell me about Austin. And I didn't tell him why. I just said, tell me about Austin, because I might be doing something there. Kept it cryptic. And he told me about it, and I said, you know, how cold does it get? I need a coat? And he went, no, you'll need a jacket. And our first night shoot, it snowed. It was a blizzard. And I phoned him up, and I went, it's snowing in Austin. And he went, no, it's not. And I went, yes, it is, and sent him a picture of it. And he went, oh, yeah, it's snowing. So he lies. But it's still great having him because he's, even before we did a sing together, we'd become really good friends. So it was good having him.
This is a great question from Instagram from Heather Wilson. Lenny, how do you think Morgan would react if he knew Rick was gone / missing?
Oh, what a... I think he would go looking to prove it either one way or the other. I think he would walk back across the country. I think he'd walk back and forward. It would become his new mission. He would have to find him. I think one of the things about Morgan is he still defines himself by that man and that friendship and the fact that those two men know each other in a way that they don't allow anybody else to know them. So it will be very fundamental to him.
Okay. Austin, and you are from Austin.
I am, yeah.
And how's it been shooting in your hometown?
Just better breakfast tacos. No, it's been incredible. I have a history. That's where I started off acting, and now I'm back shooting the only show in my hometown, and we're you know, we shoot on locations, so we go to all these like amazing, we go out into the hill country, we're in these really cool spots, so it's been incredible. I love it. And I get to see my kid at night and in the morning, and I get to work with all these people and travel around Texas. This is the dream, right? This is it.
Fantastic. And then this is for Andrew and Ian. At Jesse McGuire on Twitter says, Andrew and Ian, are there any plans to utilize Ruben's musical talent in a storyline?
I think it would be...
He's a pretty big deal.
It would be insane to have Ruben Blades on your show and not use his singing talent.
And I'd say by the time the season is over, we will hear Ruben Blades sing on the show.
Actually, in our rap party, we listened to him sing. It was amazing.
Yeah, wait, Ruben, do you put the tour on hold while you're shooting the show, or do you just go?
No, my band wants a zombie to bite me so I can die. And they're not nice people. No, what happens is that the band is working. I just go whenever we can, but we do have a very long schedule in the show, as you know.
Yeah.
And also, once the show is done, I mean, I really need some time off for my family, my wife, and you know. And so I sometimes do some gigs. I mean, I just got some invitations for next year to do some touring with jazz guys now. So we'll see, you know. But this is my primary responsibility, the show.
Okay. Let's take a few fan questions right over here. Hello.
Hello.
Wait, let's get your mic on. Hello?
Is it on?
Yes, you are on. Welcome. What is your name?
My name is Josh Garcia.
Hello.
And my question's for Danai Garcia.
Hi.
And my question is, since you directed a short film before, do you intend to work in writing and directing for other mediums like features? And if so, how has acting in this show helped you in that process?
Oh, great question. You know, I've been blessed to be around a cast that is multitasking, like Lenny James, he's a writer right here. Coleman Domingo, he's writer, director. We have other cast members come and shadow from The Walking Dead, and it's just really inspiring to see, you know, actors explore different parts of, you know, their talents. And they keep saying, why don't you keep doing it? Just keep doing it on your time off. And it's really cool to have that, you know, reassurance from your cast and the people you hang out with most of the day for like 7 months out of the year. So that's really nice. And I share the stuff with them and I get their feedback, and it's amazing. And yeah, I would love to keep exploring, you know, other stories, and I'm actually in the work for more things. And I'm very proud of this first short that I did. It's called La Cura. We just premiered at the Baja California International Film Festival, and the entire crew of Fear the Walking Dead in Baja came to the premiere. It was amazing. I'm just to send them big hello to everybody, and I love them so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for your question. Hi, what's your name?
Hi, my name is Angelina. Chris, welcome back.
Thank you. Nice to see you. Nice to see you. Hey, how are you guys?
love you. Stop it.
A great hat, by the way.
That is an amazing
thank
hat.
You. Thank really you. Great. My question is how long did it take to film the opening plane crash scene, and how daunting was it?
We had a 10-day schedule, and I think probably like 4 of it were the plane crash, and it also rained during it. I think Maggie gets the MVP because she was out in the actual rain in like the middle of the night. Getting rained on for that final scene.
She worked on Lost! It's old hat!
At least I don't have to wear the damn heels on.
But it took like weeks of preparation to get the plane there and dig up the ground and do all that. It was a pretty cool thing to see.
Great, thank you so much. Thanks for your question. Hi, what is your name?
My name is Sean Robinson, and my question is, the show started off as a prequel to The Walking Dead. And at some point, the timeline is much more current to The Walking Dead. When was the decision made to change the format, and why?
Yeah, I mean, I was going to say,
No, you go. No, I think that's you.
A lot of it was about getting deeper into the apocalypse so we could see how everyone was surviving and just what it cost everyone.
I would say we're not on the same timeline as The Walking Dead. They are now still several years ahead of us. So while we've caught up and done some time jumps, it still very much occupies its own space in the timeline.
Cool. Thank you. That's it? That's all the time we have for questions? Okay, great. No worries. Let me go to a couple more social questions then. This is for Maggie Grace. Bobby on Facebook says, Maggie, there's a lot of mystery and unknown surrounding Fear the Walking Dead. This was also a trend on Lost. Do you enjoy working on shows that slowly let the audience peek behind the curtain?
Yes.
Dude in the front goes, nailed it. Let's see. What would, we already got to this. Deny, I already asked you this. Season 4 was all about revenge. What? Oh, I got this, you guys. I remember how to do this stuff. What, when the show comes back, are we like full throttle? Is there a buildup? Or are we just dropping back in on the beginning of season 5B?
Oh. Well, something that you may have picked up on in the trailer is we've seen things filmed from Al's camera before, but you may have noticed in the trailer we see other people filming as well. So we're gonna see that episode, 509, is filmed in a very different way than we've done our episodes in the past. And without giving away why, it's sort of a documentary format to the episode, which is going to catch us up to where the group is and what they're doing, but you're gonna be experiencing it in a very different way.
Just like The Office.
This is for Jenna Mendel20 on Twitter. And this is a good question, because everyone on the show is pretty funny. What do you do to lighten the mood between the scenes, or do you have to be serious on set all the time? What happened?
I say this with fondness, Jenna always makes everyone laugh.
I make you laugh because you love me so. I love you. I don't know. I think, you know, we have actually a lot of funny things that come from the environment. Like we had these goats, you know, show up and do insane things. That came out really. You know, I think we have moments where, I mean, there's a lot of people on the cast who like to sing, you know, so, and Coleman is usually really the rabble rouser in terms of keeping it really quite humorous.
Right.
So I think the hat goes to Coleman on that one.
Well, also because the show, I don't know, it is an emotionally, like all the Walking Dead Universe shows, all 10 of them, they're so emotionally draining, and when you watch the show, you feel like emotionally exhausted, but as a performer, it's nonstop. I mean, how do you find that line in between sort of screwing around so you don't go crazy or shaking off all the drama from the day, but being able to get back into the moments that you need to get into?
Yeah, it is a thing on set. Like, I kind of just am in a zone a little bit, and I have to go for walks at the end of the day quite often just to, you know.
Also, we're very lucky with our crew because they're very funny and kind of supportive, and they get the gag, they get what we're doing, and there's a lot of laughter going on amongst the crew. There was one day where we were all the scenes were being interrupted by gunfire. And we kind of found out that there's a gun range just over the hill, and they kept shooting the guns, and they were interrupting our filming.
Was that when you were taking the shower?
We should send someone over and ask them to stop. And everybody was like, well, who are we going to send? Who wants to go over the hill and tell the guys to stop firing the guns?
And then lastly for Karen, what was the most unexpected thing, or when you joined the cast of Fear, joining a different kind of show than you've ever done before, what was something that really surprised you that you enjoyed?
Well, Ian did tell me after our, I think, final meeting, he said, there's no magic carpet rides in the apocalypse, Karen. And I was like, okay, I was hoping there might have been. I was super excited because I love my beloved shows Galavant and Once Upon a Time, and any Galavant Once Upon a Time? And I got to wear such beautiful costumes and shiny crowns and beautiful corseted gowns. And when I came on here, I remember Jo, our wonderful costume designer, she said, Karen, it's going to be a combination of thrift style fashion meets Goodwill. You're going to love it. Lots of dirt and blood. And I was so excited. I was like, yeah, this is great. And it was the shortest time that I'm in the makeup and hair chair, which excites me to no end. And I'm just like, the more dirt, the more blood, like, bring it on. And the dirt underneath my nails is so great. But my mom forgets, because my mom's so used to these other roles. So she's like, oh, you know, Karen, you've got a bit of dirt under your nails. You know, you might want to clean that. And she just can't get it in her head that there is such a thing as makeup dirt. So.
And then you're in the apocalypse.
Yeah, and then I'm in the apocalypse.
Well, I want to thank you all for coming out to the Fear the Walking Dead panel at Comic-Con 2019. The mid-season finale of Fear is this Sunday, followed by an all-new Talking Dead, and then the mid-season premiere of Fear is Sunday, August 11th, also followed by a Talking Dead. I'm Chris Hardwick, and then I'll be Chris Hardwick in a second when I run off stage and then awkwardly run back on 3 minutes later, like I wasn't just up here. But when I come back...